where we find you, dear wing, in the half dark on the way back from the piglets. Your knuckle of raw bone and a streak of claw white quills torn from the socket. A grey goose soars up high where hot air balloons drift and the wind is a shape to wrap yourself around, solid but unseen, a somersault inside the womb. Here, folded to a cup of hands, plump as a wood pigeon in the long, flat January grass, you are singular and intense, like a girl breathing quietly by a window, her just cut hair pressed against the glass. So I thought I'd read some of my watery poems. An Aviary of Small Birds, as Rachel said, was a sort of book of commemoration and elegies. Really around, I mean, sort of wanting to sort of reach my baby son who died in childbirth. And at the time, I just felt so incredibly comforted by being on in or near water. So a lot of my poems have water at the heart of them. This is on the Thames. The houseboat tilts into the water at low tide. Ducklings slip in mud. Nothing is stable in this limbo summer where he leaves his shoes in the flat. She decides to let a room. The ad says, only 10 minutes to the tube. I have a washing machine and a cat. The truth, more of a struggle than anyone cares to admit. And everywhere, progress. An imprint of cranes on the skyline, white fans on bridges, the shard shooting up to the light like a foxglove. I wrote that, I kind of, I imagined this little residency out of something, like, yeah, really, it was great. And I had this residency on an old Dutch barge, right in the middle of the Thames as well. So just spent the winter and summer to get out to it, because the mooring was right in the middle, we had to get on a little rig, sort of zoom down the Thames, and it's very magical. And indirectly that led to me having a residency at the National Maritime Museum in 2015, and they invited me to come and respond to an exhibition on migration, and particularly maritime migration, which I did. And while I was there, I had access to all their archives, which are really amazing. And my dad came to the UK from Jamaica in 1957 as part of the Windrush generation. And he came in 57. And when I was at the National Maritime Museum, I actually found his name in the logbook of the ship that he came on, which was incredibly exciting. And just somehow seeing it there. And so those records are still safe at the National Maritime Museum, which is good, because they're not safe everywhere in this country, as we know. Anyway, I decided, yeah, I've got to get on the ship, and I want to do the journey myself. I want to find the ship. It's called the Opinia. Anyway, it didn't exist. It had gone to the breakers yard. I did discover, though, that this ship had been chartered. It was chartered for the set of a film called Voyage of the Damned. And I was like, oh my god, it sounds like some kind of, I don't know, it sounds like some sort of B-movie horror or something, zombies or something. But it's not that at all. It actually was for another, a totally different story, but it turned out to be another migration story. So I tell you all this as I'm about to read the poem Voyage, because it tells the story of the ships, sort of two lives, as it were, and the two migration stories in there together. Voyage of the Damned is a film from the 1970s, starring Faye Dunaway with her cat's eyes and cheekbones. The Opinia is the name of the ship the producers chartered to use as the set. Many Rivers to Cross was your favourite song. As requested, we played it at your funeral. Opinia is the name of the ship you board at Kingston Harbour, where you had a good job as a customs official. Voyage of the Damned is a film set on a ship in 1939, when 1,000 Jewish refugees fled Germany for Cuba. Irpinia is a region south of Naples, full of mountains and many rivers. Its name means wolf in the language of the ancient tribes. Voyage of the Damned is a true story, where the wolf wears a uniform and spits out bones and teeth. Dunn's River is a brand of ackee, a fruit that's poisonous if picked unripe. It only comes here tinned. On the Opinia, you organise a committee of West Indian chefs to cook for those who find the food too fresh. A term that doesn't mean the same thing as it does in England. Rivers of is misquoted and comes from the legend of Aeneas, who said he saw the Tiber course through his city of wolves, foaming with much blood. Opinia is close to the hot mouth of Vesuvius, a verdant passage from the Tyrrhenian to the Adriatic. Voyage of the Damned was transatlantic. The liner set sail for the Caribbean, full of hope and families looking for a way in. Cassava River runs in between Above Rocks and Glen Goff, the village from which your mother, Catherine Weir, migrated to the capital. On the Opinia, people are crowded into dorms like cattle stalls in the middle of the ocean. Voyage of the Damned is a tale of propaganda and dodgy visas. The Nazis knew Cuba never planned to take refugees, even as a stepping stone. Opinia's passenger log has your date of birth wrong. It's hardly a luxury liner. The Grimaldi brothers snatched the fleet up cheap, seeing promise in the migrant market. Golden River froths downstream from Mizpah, Zion Hill, and Suki Gal in your childhood parish. Opinia's earthquake of the 1980s left 300,000 homeless. Voyage of the Damned was doomed. SS St. Louis sailed back to Europe, where countries quibbled over quotas. Only a third made it through the war alive. The Opinia docks at Southampton. You're here to join your sons and wife. A nurse called Cutie in a fledgling NHS, hungry for a beginning. So it was interesting to sort of think about migration at the Maritime Museum, and it was at this time, it was 2015, and it was coming up to the referendum, felt that, to me, I just sort of felt that there was this kind of rhetoric in the language that became very frenzied. And I decided to do an audit of all the magazines and newspapers in one day, and just like look at the language that was used around migration. And then I started to think about what would be the opposite type of language. And so this poem uses the language that is reserved really to write about the super rich, to tell the migrant narrative. This is hapless people who really matter. And that is the name of their rich list. You can find it online. Although we might think them wildly intimidating, many are astonishingly cosy and nice. She is not a perfect English rose, but he has the loveliest, gorgeous, glossy hair. Imagine how super clever and super connected and affable one must be to have got this far. Considering they are not all trained, many are relentlessly upbeat and frighteningly talented. Boundlessly energetic, they approach each border as if it were new, even after umpteen impressive attempts. Mind-blowingly otter-faced, she tells the little ones everything's going to be just fine. The lie, flawless as pale skin. Some might call it pneumatic. When they get through, it is delightful. Yeah, so that uses the adjectives and the adverbs from Tatler's list. This is of ownership. It's a golden shovel. It's a derivative form. It's after the poet Joy Harjo, from a poem of hers called A Map to the Next World. The verb has a long history of violence. To take is to grab, seize, or capture, especially by force. Note its hard K set against the long vowel. A sign of intent, this cave of sound. He took her by the throat and shook her, is one in a proliferation of examples. To enter into possession or use of anything, anything, the things of supermarkets that lull us as we push the trolley round and round the soothing fountains in the mouths, always the polystyrene trays of flesh bright in the fluorescent aisle. Our virgins at such altars now are birds who've never felt the drum of rain on their fattened breasts. Save money. Buy one, get one free in variations thereon. They, the shops, are here to help themselves as best they can. Language is also ownership. We describe our thoughts and by default corral the heart. Most articulation is squandered as a detour from love that manifests as pain inside us, from what is felt, from breath that connects us to grace. True love. We learn to conjugate être before avoir, a mystery made overt by absence, this unstrung lute. Imagine a tree, an abundant avocado, the lure of creamy fruit. Revel in it. Allow your eyes to roam the room forever. When it's over, pain scratches a root to the heart. Quick as an elva and on repeat, a brutal lout. The act no man can veto. Bow to its rule. that's in the audience. So I'll just give you a mini geeky note, and that is in a form called a grammarband invented by the poet Terence Hayes. But it's a little bit of a hybrid because grammarband normally has 11 lines, this has 14, so it's a bit like a sonnet, it's a sort of love poem. The grammarband is anagrammatic of the title, so true love, and the end word of each line is anagrammatic of that phrase. Geek note over. So we did a workshop this morning, and I realised I wanted to think about trees. There's a lot of trees here at the Whitworth. They're an important part of the placing of the gallery and lots of work within. They're important to my life and all of our lives, I think. I'm going to read this one, Horse Chestnut One, a coupling. It's a form in which I take a paragraph of prose, lineate it, and write a response line underneath. And this is a response to a letter that Charles Darwin wrote to a friend of his. So I sort of say it's a bit like a sort of, it's kind of influenced by the sort of formally by interest I have in music. So it's a sort of junglist mashup between me and Charles Darwin. Horse Chestnut One coupling. And this is kind of another elegy as well to the horse chestnut that fell in my back garden and is no more. I wrote a few of them. This is my... And I wrote a lot of elegies, I wrote a lot about death, and then I decided I needed to write something that sort of was maybe a bit different. So what's the opposite? Maybe sex. P.S. As horse chestnuts have male flowers, when a man comes into his flowering season. And hermaphrodite flowers I wish to examine, with petals soft and tender as breasts, open to bear their pollen, his seed. And this has made me observe, and this has made me, a thing which has surprised me. All the flowers, an entreaty, flowering labiate, now open on my several trees, now open and in profusion, are male with rudimentary pistil, are female too, rude and raw, with pollen shedding. So that I began to think how dishevelled I was, how my memory had deceived me into enamour, and that the pistil was never well developed, and that the pestles are well deep and enveloped. But on opening, as I opened, my eyes like buds near the end of each little lateral twig, sticking overt, receptive of the flower truss, I find a cluster of plenty of hermaphrodite flowers with pistils in abundance, asphodels forever pulsing, pert yet well developed, so that on all my trees, my roots, these roots attest, there has been a gigantic crop of quite useless ideas, and oh, how intoxicating the air. As male flowers with millions of pollen grains wasted open, as the male he flowers swollen and unsated. For there is not a female flower nearly open, for there is not a female or a flower so open. I always feel weird when I read that. Something dumb when doing things I just don't know. Anyway, I'll finish with a short one, Evolution. A man is really very like a frog. Brain in a brain box, eyes, ears, nose, mouth and teeth, but unlike the vast man-frog plan, man is more like a frog than a fish. A frog and man possess, and a fish does not. But man is less like a frog than a dog, for man and dog both have hair and divided hearts, and warm blood of several different sorts, and milk. And frogs have none of these things. In terms of classification, men and dogs are, frogs are not.